We start this morning. I looked through the bulletin. There's a couple announcements about ways that we can be giving Samaritan's Shoebox and the Baptist Center, updating a membership form. I do want to just continue to keep reminding you about Thursday night. We had another really good time of prayer Thursday night. So if you're free in the evening, you're able to come join us for prayer. The men's prayer time at 7:30 on Friday has been really, really good. Thursday. Did I say Friday? Thursday at 7:30 is really good. Also, I wanted to take this time. This morning, right after the service, there is a lunch for the people that are on Johnny's deacon's list. And I'm looking around. I think everybody's here. So let me get Johnny. Johnny, do you mind standing up just real quick? Everyone knows who you are, of course. But if you're a deacon, will you stand up? So Johnny and Gerald. Gerald's in the back. Okay. Gerald's canes up at least. We're glad. Thank you for what you do. The reason I wanted you to do that is I think sometimes we just assume things. And we've had deacons list for a long time where deacons have certain people that they're there to look after. I'm glad that Johnny's done this for the folks that are in his group, and I wanted just to say that any of you, if you ever have needs, those deacons that just stood up would love to be able to help you. It's not something that they're wishing they don't have to do. They're excited when they're able to do something for you. And there are some others that are what we call yoke fellows that are people that are helping them as well. And their phone numbers are also there. So if you don't have a deacon's list, I think we recently put one in everyone's box. But I think Christy, do you have a copy?
There's extra copies next to the mailbox.
There's extra copies next to the mailbox. So if you need to get that to see who your deacon is. And again, the point is, if you have a need, physical, spiritual, whatever, these are people that they are here to help. They would love to be able to do that. So I'm very thankful for deacons and for specifically these six men here. Bill Ailey is the other one. He's not here this morning. I knew I was only counting five in my head. I know where Bill is this morning. He's preaching this morning. So anyway, definitely talk to one of those people. That's what they're here for. Secondly, the Lottie Moon is finished. We did meet our goal. We raised $3,031 for Lottie Moon. So praise the Lord for that. Let's see. What I want to do as we have our prayer time this morning is I want to specifically be thinking about how we can serve each other as believers. So the deacons are an example. They should be a role model for us as church members. We had this conversation Thursday night that if you look at what the requirements are for being a deacon, if you look at what their roles are, there's hopefully no one that says, well, I don't want to be a deacon because I don't want to have to do that work. That should never be our... It's a responsibility for those who are deacons to do this, but it ought to be something that all of us are striving to do. And that means, as a body, that we care about each other, that we serve each other, we're looking after each other. So as we begin the service in prayer, let's spend some time praying for each other. So let's pray.
Thank you. We'd like you to join us and sing along with us in our bulletins. We have the little choruses. Open our eyes, Lord. Let's all stand and sing it together. Everyone.
You may be seated for prayer.
Let's all pray together. Father, we thank you for your blessings. We thank you for all that you do for us from day to day, Lord. So many things that we take for granted. Just pray you'd be with us in this service this morning, Lord. May we realize the all-powerful, the gracious, and the mercy that you provide for us, Lord. May we get a glimpse of a picture of just how all-powerful, all-knowing you really are. And may we get a picture of Christ, Lord, the Savior of our lives, but also the one that will be King and Judge over our lives. We just pray, God, that we could get a glimpse of him in our mind this morning as well. We thank you, God, for the blessings you give us. We thank you for your healing, and thank you for returning those to us, Lord, that has been sick. And we just pray you continue to be with those that face uncertainty and face surgeries and face ill health. Just pray you'd be with them as well. And we pray that your spirit would be here among us today. And especially, God, if there's one here that's lost, that your spirit would touch that heart today. Help us that we could love others and do unto others as you'd have us to do. And these things I ask in Christ's name. Amen.
to invite you to stand and shake hands as we play the family of God. It's fellowship time. Find your seats, we'll all sing it together. Here we go.
Brady, will you pray for us this morning?
Lord, we come this morning seeking you. Lord, we seek your face. Lord, you let us in not because we're worthy, Lord, but because you are gracious and merciful. Lord, the fact that you would seek fellowship with me as a minister, I cannot understand, Lord, and I am so thankful. Lord, you are worthy of our worship today. Lord, we have opportunities to worship and obedience as we sing. Lord, we see that now as we approach the opportunity to be worshipful in obedience and tithing. Lord, I pray that every gift would be given cheerfully. Lord, that you would bless these efforts, Lord, and that you would soften our hearts for what you have for us today, Lord, that you would change us, that we would be renewed by your word, Lord, that we would glorify you as we leave this place throughout this week. Lord, our petitions enter the throne room because of your work on the cross and the Lord. So thankful for what you're doing in this church. I'm thankful that you brought me to this church, Lord. I'm thankful for what you're doing in the lives of young men. I pray that you would continue to move and we would always point back and praise you for what you're doing. Lord, we ask all these things in your name. Amen.
have our children come forward for a children's sermon this morning. Can I have the baby? Thank you. Thank you. Good to see you all this morning. One more, come on. I'll wait. Great. I've brought a couple of toys with me. Matter of fact, you've probably seen Hannah walking around. She was thrilled that she was allowed to have her toy at church. These aren't just toys. These happen to be Hannah's favorite toy of all of her toys and Obadiah's favorite toy of all of his toys. And just for you adults to see, it's always amazing to me how some of the least expensive toys are some of their favorite. Would y'all agree? That always seems to be the case. And what I wanted to do, I quizzed them. I decided not to do it live in front of everybody, but I asked them what their favorite toy was and if they would let me talk about it in church this morning. And I also asked them if it was okay if I could tell everyone how they played with their favorite toy. I thought that would be interesting just to hear. And y'all all have favorite toys. Raise your hand if you can think of one toy. Don't tell me what it is, but raise your hand if you can think of one toy of all of your toys that's your favorite. All right, I thought that would be the case. There's just one. All right, well, hold on to it. I won't ask you for it this morning. I just want you to think about it. This is Obadiah's favorite. And when I asked him, I wish I could remember word for word how he said it. I asked him, how do you play with this toy? He said, I zoom around with it. And that's his answer. I said, well, do you go anywhere? Nope, I'm just zooming with it. So what he likes to do, and this is true, Obadiah wanders through the house and you can hear him. You know if he has a toy in his hand because he doesn't just walk, right? When he walks, there's a noise coming out of his mouth. You know, and it's on the wall and it's on the roof and it's on the ground, right? So this type of toy is the type of toy that is really good for going places. And it makes you, when you think about it as a child, and you're playing with the toy, it makes you think about what it would be like for this thing to be going places. This is Flower Baby, is that right? All right, this is Flower Baby, it's the name of the baby doll. And when I asked Hannah, what's your favorite thing to do with Flower Baby? How do you play with Flower Baby? And she said, I play family. And so, what does family look like? Well, she said, actually, if you notice, all of my baby dolls are in really good condition because I treat them like real babies. And that's what she does. She takes care of it, right? She does everything that she needs to for the baby. She goes to work and leaves the baby at home, right? So she can work on her computer at work. And I mean, she plays with her baby, and this is what she's doing. I think it's interesting, and this is what I wanted y'all as kids to think about this morning. Whenever you play a game, your game is always, whenever you play pretend, you're always pretending to do something. No one ever just pretends to not do. That's a silly thing to do, right? I think that's interesting. This morning, what I'm going to be talking about is I'm going to be talking about the way God made Adam and Eve. Last week we talked about how God put Adam and Eve in the garden. This week I want to talk about what Adam and Eve were created to do, what their purpose was. And I think it's interesting, even as very young children, you understand that you have something you want to be doing. Purpose is important. So let's pray and then you can go back to your seats. Lord, may your name be exalted this morning in your word. I pray that as we read your word, that your great name would be lifted up, that you would be praised, and that you would help us, Lord, to recognize the purposes that you have for us, and that we would be faithful to do them. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can go back to your seats. Here you go, Hannah. I'll let you take that. Turn with me to Genesis chapter 2. We are screaming through the book of Genesis at a rapid pace. By the end of today, we probably will be pretty close to being done with chapter 2. In all seriousness, though, I've really struggled with these first couple of chapters because of the amount of theological material that the Lord has given for us in these chapters. It is not light. There's a lot of stuff here for us. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to begin. We read chapter 2, verse 5 last week, but I'd like to read it again. And what I want to do, I'll just read all the way to the end of the chapter, and then we'll back up and begin discussing things. All right. When no bush of the field was yet in the land, and no small plant of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord had not caused it to rain on the land, and there was no man to work the ground, and a mist was going up from the land and was watering the whole face of the ground, then the Lord God formed the man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living creature. And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the garden the Lord God made to spring up every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life was in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. A river flowed out of Eden to water the garden, and there it divided and became four rivers. The name of the first is Pishon. It is the one that flowed around the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold, and the gold of that land is good. Bdellium and onyx stones are there. The name of the second river is Gihon. It is the one that flowed around the whole land of Cush. And the name of the third river is the Tigris, which flows east of Assyria. And the fourth river is the Euphrates. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, "You may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die." Then the Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make a helper fit for him." Now out of the ground the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all livestock and to the birds of the heavens and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helper fit for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man. And while he slept, he took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed." May God add his blessing to his word. The first thing that we see in verses 5 and 6, when no bush of the field was yet in the land, and no small plant of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord had not caused it to rain on the land, and there was no one to work the ground. What we're told here is that there is no plant, and there's a reason there's no plant. It's because, what does it say? There had been no rain, and there was no man. So as we look at the purposes of man, one of the things that we see before the fall, before anything went wrong, we were told that we should labor, that there's an effort to what it is that we do. When I was thinking about the kids playing, it amazes me that little girls want to be mothers. They want the effort that's involved with that. Talk to a mother, or you, if you are one, think about it. You have a lot that you do. And children desire that. They desire to go outside, and if they can't mow, then they want a pretend lawnmower to push around. And if they can't sweep, they want a pretend broom. And they're going to play kitchen. And they're going to play construction. And they're going to demonstrate this fact that we have a desire to do things. One of the hardest things about getting older, from what I understand, is trying to make sure you still understand what it is that you can do. Because it's built into us. We want to be doing things. And when God made man, before man was in the garden wasn't right yet. Man was necessary to the garden. He had a job to do, and in the same way, we've been created with a job to do. Now, sin makes things complicated, right? So now, instead of just gardening, now we have to get the weeds out of the garden, and we garden by the sweat of our brow. So things are tougher because of the fall. But there are some people in our culture, because of our enormous amount of luxuries that have gotten to the point that we actually think the best thing in life is to not have to work. And that is not true. The ability to work is something that we were given by God at creation before the fall. It is a good thing. It is a purpose that we have. God has given us a job to do. And that makes me excited. I like waking up in the morning knowing I have things to do. It's good. Okay. Then we learn about how it is that man is formed. If you back up to chapter 1, verse 26, you see that when God made man, he says, "Then God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens." So we see that God made man in God's image, but in chapter 2, we learn a little bit more about that. "Then the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living creature." Okay? I think our second purpose that we have is we are to represent. We have been given the image of God, made in the image of God, and we have his breath. Matter of fact, if you notice in your notes, I made a change since I sent this to Christy. It's not Christy's fault, it's mine. But anyway, you get the idea, I think. In your bulletin, you can figure out what I was going for. So we have his breath. And because we have his breath, we bear his image. Matter of fact, if you want to think about it like this, all that God created is here. Some of it is what we call alive. It's physical. It's made out of dust. All of the animals were made from the earth. Okay? And then over here, we have the spiritual world. So God himself is spirit, but also the angels that he created, their spirit. And there's a lot there. And then man sits in between this world. If you think about it, we represent to the physical world, we represent the spiritual world to the physical world. I don't want to say it too strongly, but that's exactly what a priest does. A priest represents God to man and represents man to God. And in a sense, even Adam and Eve, before the fall, at the very beginning of the creation, were in a place where they represented the image of the spiritual to the physical. They had the opportunity to be kind of like priests. Now, I put this picture up here for two reasons. First off, it shows someone bearing the image, and you kind of get the idea. Someone looks in the image and they in the mirror and they see Christ. But this is a dangerous picture. Because very often what happens is we try to make God into our image. We flip it, right? So in a way, this picture is one of the most least accurate things that could be for me to look at my own face and start interpreting it as God's face. That's dangerous. Instead, what I desire is that when others see me, they do see Christ instead of me. I bear his image. And now that the fall has happened, again, what happened at the fall, you remember death happened right away? What kind of death was that? Jesus, God said, on the day that you eat of it, you shall die. We read that last week. Did that happen? Absolutely that happened. But on the day that Eve ate the fruit, she didn't physically die. So what happened? Her spirit died. And now we, as the new creation in Christ, given his spirit, are back in the same position where we are representing the spiritual world to the physical world. We bear his image, and that is a big deal. This one doesn't wake me up excited in the morning. This one helps me helps my feet find the floor. It keeps me from being so arrogant just to think I'll just go do whatever and I want. I can't. I'm bearing the image of my God. There are people who are looking at me that their understanding of the spiritual world is influenced by me and by you. So our first purpose is to labor. God has given us things to do. Our second purpose is to represent the Lord. We bear his image. Just a quick aside, going back to chapter 1, verse 26, I want to read verse 27. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created him. I want to just sit here for just a second and say, today's culture is struggling to figure out what the difference between male and female is. Okay, and if you're not sure, how can you even be confused about such a thing? What they've done is they said, well, if I feel like a female, it doesn't matter what I look like. And they've confused feelings with fact, if you will. And there's a lot more to it. I don't mean to make it sound like just a small issue. It's a major issue. And it's one that is very seriously being debated in society today. One way we as Christians need to be crystal clear, and that is what the Bible teaches. There are people out there that say, well, look, God, it always says he about God, therefore God is man, therefore, looking back at this picture, man made God in his image because man is the stronger of the two and can make women do what they want them to, and therefore God looks like a man because men have been stronger over the years, and there's a lot of nonsense there. And what I want you to see is that the Bible teaches us that not just man bears the image of God, but man and woman. And God makes it clear enough to stop and pause. So let me read verse 27 again. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created him. What's happening here is God is telling us very clearly that both men and women are made in the image of God. Both are. We both represent the image of who God is. And that's important. When women try to get rid of their womanhood and become something else, they quit representing God like they ought to. And when men try to get rid of their manhood, they quit representing God in the correct way. So we have an image to bear. It's his image. And we should take that with a great deal of seriousness. Thirdly, I'm going to jump down. Last week we talked quite a bit about the rivers and what was happening in the garden. So I want to jump down to verse 15. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded man, saying, you may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. I want you to think about something here. I'm sure a lot of you in here have wrestled with, why did God put a tree in the garden? Why was there a rule? Have you ever thought through that? Wouldn't it have been nice if God had just not let there be this tree that Eve could have done wrong? Wouldn't that have been good? Why is it that God had to put a temptation in the garden before sin? Now, when we answer why questions about why God does things, I don't think we ever can say this is the answer. Because God is a big God and we are not big people. So his ways are always going to be above his ways. But I want to show you one this morning for you to think through. Okay? One of the jobs that we were given is to have dominion over the earth. We were to rule the earth. We were to be in charge of the earth. What does that mean? That means that we were given the responsibility to make rules for those that were under us. Okay? Now, how can we give rules if we haven't learned to obey rules? It just doesn't work that way. Leadership always begins with first you learn how to follow, and then you can learn to lead, and not before. So I believe that even in this one, in verse 15, when the Lord put this one tree and told him not to eat, there was a purpose there. And the purpose was that we are supposed to lead. And the way we lead is we obey God. That's how we lead. And because we lead that way, We have a role. We have a job to do. Again, we're bearing the image of God. People are looking to us. And as they look to us, we have something we ought to be doing. And that's obeying God. And God allowed Adam and Eve in at the very beginning to have a way that they could obey. Even in the physical world, the fact that they did not obey God led to others not obeying God. I don't understand all of this, but you remember, what do animals eat? When God made the animals, what did He say that they would eat? Grass of the field, every one of them. And as we understand it, it was the fall of man that brought not just death to the animals, but it also made the animals no longer behave as God had intended for them to behave. They quit obeying God. What I'm saying has worked its way out. Adam and Eve, in their leadership role, demonstrated that they would disobey God. And because they did, not just Adam and Eve, but the creation groans because they have followed their leader. Now, the responsibility is on us. That's why we have to put cages around animals to keep them from other animals and protect them. We're having to teach the animals again what we should have taught them at the beginning, that there is a right order to things and this is how it should look. That's why, we'll get into things that aren't important. So that rule, and a lot of people have talked about the rule being a sign of free will, and I believe that too. If we didn't have the choice, we couldn't have a choice. And having a choice is a big deal. It's a big gift. I agree with that. But I'm just saying that if we're going to have dominion, if we're going to be making rules, it is only fitting that we're following rules. So we have a purpose. One of our purpose is to lead. Verse 18. Then the Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him." Now, out of the ground, the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called that every living creature, that was its name. There's another purpose that I believe all mankind have in one way or another, and that is that we were made to create. I was walking through just a list. Matter of fact, if you want to play this game with me, come tell me a job that you're doing and how it is you get to create while you're doing it. And you'll find every one of you in your role does something that is a creative act. What he did is he said, "I want you to name the animals." What did God name? Anyone know? Someone call it out. What did God name? The stars. The stars of the heaven were told that God is the one who named the stars. There were some things that God named. God is the one who named the light and the darkness. God is a naming God. That's what he's done. And when he created man, it was a great gift that what he did is, "I'm going to bring all the animals to you. You're going to name them. And that's what it's going to be called." He allowed Adam to be a creator just like he is a creator. He couldn't call it into existence, right? So God had to make the rhinoceros, and all Adam got to do was say, "That's a rhinoceros." Matter of fact, it reminds me a great deal of when I have a younger child that's beginning to work with me, those are the kinds of jobs I normally give my children. Right, if I'm nailing something, I get it started, I get it about 3/4 of the way, and I say, "Okay, you nail this one." And while they're working on that one with their really little hammer, I'll nail the rest of it, right? And they feel like they're contributing, and they are. They have gotten to be creators with me of whatever it is that we're making. God did that. Out of the dust of the earth, hippo, what do you want to call it? All right, this is our hippo. Giraffe, what do you want to call it? Okay, this is our giraffe. God the creator allowed man the creation to participate with him in creating names. If you're at a job and you think, "Man, I do not like this job," one thing you can do is figure out what it is you're doing that's creative in your role. Police officer, you have to creatively find people that you need to be found. I mean, I could go through every, I think we could go through everything and you would see that there is a gleam of this creation business in all that we do. That is God-given. God has made us creators. Okay. Last point. But give me, this last point's an important one, so it's going to take a minute. So starting in verse 21. Oh, I remembered. Sorry, I wanted to make a comment about Revelation, about Genesis in general, just for everyone to understand. This is a place where people have kind of swirled around and gotten stuck on some different things. Here's what people will say. Genesis chapter 1 says, God made all the animals, then God made man last. Male and female, God made them. And they come to chapter 2 and they read, God took the man that he formed and put him in the garden. And then what is this about making animals again? He made animals and brought it to him. And what does that mean? So if you've never had that question asked and you don't care, great. But if anyone's ever asked you that question, here's my understanding. God invented the idea of a giraffe. In the Garden of Eden, God brought to man a giraffe. Does it make sense? The world might have been filled with giraffes, but they weren't in the Garden of Eden. And so there needed to be one where he was. So God made Adam. God allowed Adam to name all of the animals. This is all on day 6. Then God put Adam to sleep. And then God made woman. And that was the end of that 6th day. It's a busy day. But I don't think that we should think that everything we call a species is what God made Adam name that day. Okay? Thousands and thousands of animals, right? But I can show you 15 different pictures of something that we call a different species of cat, and it is all a cat. Big cat with hair on it, we call that a lion. Little cat that walks on the ground, we call it one thing. If it has some sort of coloring, we call it Siamese. We've continued to kind of digress on all of these other names, but I don't think that what God was telling Adam to do was name all the genus and species and phyla and all of that. We invented all that later looking at the animals God created. Does that make sense? So most of you, this is probably not an issue, but there might be someone here who struggles with the scientific, just trying to sit it down and work it out in your head. That sounds like a long day. I think it was a long day. I think that very early in the morning when God made all the animals, he did that quickly so that Adam was made quickly, so that Adam had time to be naming all of these animals in a day, the ones that God brought to him. Anyway, okay, I just wanted to kind of, and if there's ever any more questions about that kind of stuff, that's one of those areas I love to go down deep. So definitely come talk to me. I'd love to talk more about the details of how physically this might have happened and what it looked like. Picking up in verse 20. The man gave names to all the livestock and the birds of the heaven and every beast of the field, but for Adam there was not found a helper fit for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and while he slept, he took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman, and he brought her to the man. Then the man said, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. The last purpose that I see that we have is one in which that we are to love each other. I was an adult before I realized that God created relationships just as surely as God created giraffes. For some reason, I thought, I don't know what I thought, I just hadn't ever got down there, hadn't thought about that. When God made Adam, he made Adam in such a way that Adam recognized he needed a relationship. And so God made Eve for the purpose of the two of them being one flesh, that they would have a relationship with each other. The statement that was made about Adam, "It is not good for man to dwell alone," is true for every one of us. None of us are meant to dwell alone. We're all meant to be in fellowship one another, with each other. That doesn't mean we're all meant to be married, but it does mean that we're all meant to have relationships with each other. What I want to do with the few minutes that we have left, and someone's saying, you don't have any time left, what are you talking about? But I'm going to take a few minutes and just go through some of the points about relationships that we see, specifically some points about love that I think we get from this passage. Okay, so love grows. First off, love grows when we realize we need each other. Notice that God didn't make Eve until Adam realized that there was not a helper suitable for him. That's important. God allowed Adam to know what it was like to not have a relationship. And you will never have a meaningful relationship with anyone if you approach that person with the idea that you don't need them. Man, we could talk for a long time about that. Sometimes the church really wants to help the community, and that's good. But a lot of times when the community comes to the church, one of the first things they feel is that we don't think we need them. Does that make sense? They come here and we say, oh good, you're our project, we'll work on you. But we don't actually treat them like people. You're just our project that we work on. We just do nice things for you. We don't care about your opinion. We just have things we need to give you. Now, what I'm saying is, when the Lord brings someone to our body, we want them to become believers because God loves them. And because God loves them, God has a purpose for them. And because God loves them and has a purpose for them, He has something that they could be doing that I need, that we need. It's important for us to recognize that we need each other. That's how relationships begin. Secondly, the Hebrew word for rib actually means side. So when it says that God made a deep sleep to come from Adam, it says that He opened up his flesh and He took out one of his sides. And it does mean rib. I'm not trying to say it means anything but rib. It means physical rib, but it also is telling us that Eve came from beside Adam. Not in front and not behind, but that word rib means beside. God made the relationship to be a sideways relationship. We stand beside each other. Again, you will never have meaningful relationships if one of you thinks they're more important than the other in the relationship. Now, I am not saying that the man is not the head of the home. God clearly teaches that. That goes back to that dominion thing that we talked about a couple weeks ago now. I am saying that we are equal in worth before the Lord. And so we stand beside each other. Thirdly, that statement at the end. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife. If you really want to see love grow, there has to be a willingness to hold on to each other. There are some people that have been visiting our church for several weeks. I could name 6 or 7 names of people that have visited here and there. When they stop coming, what are we doing? Holding fast to them? And it happens over and over again. I see it with the relationship with my kids. If I just let life go, we would drift apart. I would stay at work. They would stay at home. They would have their home things they're interested. And I am having to constantly find ways to hold fast to them. And they have to return the favor. They have to hold fast to me if our relationship is going to continue. We have to be striving to do that. That's how love grows. And we see that God tells Adam and Eve before the fall that you're going to have to leave your father and mother and hold fast to your wife. It's going to take work for y'all to hold on to each other. So, we need to know we need each other. We need to stand beside each other. We need to hold on to each other. And there's one more thing that you should see about love. especially in the bonds of marriage, although it's true everywhere, love by definition brings unity and it brings division. We don't really normally think about that. Normally we always think about how love brings us together, right? And it does. It brings us together. From where? From outside. So there's a closer group now. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit have a closer relationship with each other than anything else, anyone else, ever. Right? As much as God loves us, His relationship within Himself is different than that. Okay? And what this tells us is that a man shall leave his father and mother and then hold fast or cleave to his wife. Does it make sense? There's a division that happens. Father and mother, I love you. I will keep loving you, but our love is going to look different because I am leaving you so that I can hold on to my wife and we're going to have a new family. Again, Genesis is teaching us so much in so few verses here that it's very hard for me. We could preach for, I might even do that next Sunday. I haven't finished, I don't know where I'll be next summer Sunday. But it very well could be that I come back to look at this just in the confines of marriage and see what Jesus has to say about this. But this is important. If we're going to love each other, this unity that we have with each other will make others look at us like we're crazy. If we're going to be a church that changes Blount County, you know what it's going to look like? Weird. It's going to be strange. There's going to be people at your job that'll say, "You're doing what? It's Thursday. I thought you did something with them last night." What? You're doing something with? I thought, okay, hang on. You do something with someone from your church every night? What, are you related to them? Yes, in Christ, we are brothers and sisters, and we have joined together. We are together. And it's going to be different, and it's going to make people say, "Man, I would invite you, but I know you're busy again." Or, well, I'll quit. If your toe needs to be stepped on, I'll let the Holy Spirit do the stepping this morning. But if there are places in your life that you have not allowed this unity and division principle to be worked out, maybe you should. Okay. So, God has given us purpose, things to do. He's given us labor, that we have a job to do. He's given us an image. We're filled with His breath to represent. He's given us a role that we are to lead others in understanding what it looks like to obey God and follow Him. He's given us the ability to create. As we're made in His image, we also can create as He has created. And He's given us a command to love each other. We're to be in unity, working with each other, loving each other, bound together. Let's stand and sing this morning. Give me a chord.
Number 322. A ruler once came of salvation and light. The Master made answer in words true and plain, "Ye must be born again. Ye must be born again. Ye must be born again. I verily, verily say unto thee, ye must be born again. Ye children of men, attend to the word so solemnly uttered by Jesus the Lord, and let not this message to you be in vain. Ye must be born again. Ye must be born again.
again. I verily, verily say unto thee, ye must be born again. O ye who would enter that glorious rest and sing with the ransomed the song of the blessed, the life everlasting if ye would obtain, ye must be born again. Ye must be born again. Ye must be born again. I verily, verily say unto thee, ye must be born again.
And I'm going to have Tanner come stand with me this morning. I asked him if I could share it this way, and he said it's okay. So Thursday night, the men were praying, and what we do is, actually we talked more than usual this time, but we talked for a little while, and then we all just go around and take turns praying, and that's what we do when we come together. And Tanner said when Gary was praying, that he had a different prayer that night, that he asked Jesus to be his Savior. And so he's coming this morning. Amen. Amen. He's coming this morning to tell the church that he's been saved and he wants to follow the Lord. So I'm going to say the same thing that I said last week, that we as a church have a responsibility for discipleship. So what I want to do is we'll vote this morning. We're not voting about accepting him. He's accepted. But what we will do is, I want you, if you're willing to be part in his discipleship, will you raise your hand?
Amen.
This is our vote, that we are willing to help you, Tanner, to grow in Christ and to know him more. So I'm going to have his parents come in and join him. And after the service, y'all come and shake hands with him and welcome him into our fellowship. Is there a word this morning? Let's pray. Lord God, how wonderful it is to be worshiping you this morning. Thank you for your love for us and all that you're doing. May your name be exalted and lifted high. I thank you for Tanner and for his decision to follow you. I pray that you would bless him, help us as a church, help his parents to be faithful in discipling him and to helping him grow in his knowledge of you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.